minister, one of them, at the Christian Student Fellowship over at ETSU. It is a position I've been in for 14 years, if you can believe that. I'm getting to be pretty old. Willie Sims did not see me between the services, so I think that I'm going to try to do what was done at the beginning of the last service, in that everyone who's on the blue sheet needs to stand and be recognized. So if your name or your group is part of this thing, stand up. Go ahead. Keep standing for a second. Keep standing. Part of being able to get to preach twice in a row back to back, which is something I don't normally get to do, is that I get to amend what I've already said or how to say it. So this is what I'm about to do. You see all these people who are standing right now. Some of them you know. You know Aaron, probably. Maybe you know Kip. Maybe you know Tyson. I don't know. Certainly you know Stan. But pick somebody you don't know from this group. I'm serious about this. Pick somebody you don't know. Go ahead and find them. After the service, your job is to know who they are and what they're all about. Okay, 2 minutes worth of who they are and what they're all about, because they want to go eat lunch. So go ahead, pick them in your mind. You've got them on target. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to ruin the entire message for you. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to start with my final point. So everybody needs to stand up. This works for Tommy Oaks. I don't know. Maybe it'll work for you too. What I want to do by ruining the sermon is I'm going to tell you my last point, which is this. Missions is not something that we support. It's something that we do.
Yes.
It's something that we do that's part of us. And it's great to be recognized and recognize those who are doing something in a different way, perhaps. But that does not negate the fact that we are all missionaries and we are all called by God to serve in our place. And so instead of just praying for those who previously were standing, I'd like for you all to bow with me as I pray for all of us. Our great God, we come to you today. We acknowledge your sovereignty, your power, your glory, and your benefit to us, your grace, your love. We thank you for your commission to each one of us, to be your light in a dark place where that is. Whether it's on our street or block, our county, or the uttermost parts of Kenya. Lord, inspire each one of us today that tomorrow or this afternoon as we move around, we will interact with people in such a way that they will see and hear and know about the hope that we have because of the generosity we show, because of the manner in which we speak, because we deliver, we speak your name. Lord, use all of us as your people today, tomorrow, and the next day. May we be your emissaries, your ambassadors. Your Holy Spirit, move through us, Lord. Amen. Thank you. Have a seat. The other benefit of being able to preach sermons twice is that, man, I can just redo this whole thing. It may be the same content, but it may not be the same form at all. And I think that I'm going to be okay with that. And I think we'll be okay with you. I'm going to start out with our story, our text, which is today from Luke chapter 19, which is a story that you know. In fact, you've known since you were a wee little person when you sung about this story. It is a story about Zacchaeus. It is important to us. It's unfortunate for some reason that only Luke tells it. But just because Luke is the only person who tells it, does not mean that it's any less important because all four of them didn't mention it. This is a big deal. Sometimes I get this idea that, well, if it's re-emphasized over and over and over, I should pay attention to it. And I think that's true. But sometimes there are important things that aren't re-emphasized, and I need to pay attention to those things just as well. What we're going to find in the story, at the payoff, at the very end, are some important words, a tagline, a catchphrase, if you will. This phrase Jesus repeats over and over, and I have to admit, I told the first group, with my Bible college and seminary degree, this is something I did not know until this week when I was just preparing for this sermon. I did not know that Jesus repeats these words often. Very often. And I didn't do a word search, and I didn't count all the times because I thought that was immaterial. But Jesus says a lot of things over and over. One of the things he says over and over is, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. He's quoting Old Testament prophets. One of the things he says over and over is, I have come. Which reminds me that I need to apologize. On your bulletin this morning, it says, I have come, Mike Luzader. And it just really, it's a smack of arrogance and pomposity and all the rest of that stuff that it should be. I apologize for that. Carolyn Hammond is sort of a friend of mine. We had a, that sounds weird. I was getting ready to say we had a phone relationship, but that's not what we had. We used to speak to each other frequently on the phone. Well, Hugh Thompson was a minister here. He was a bit of a mentor of mine. He was on my board. He was chair of my board at the time. And so I would frequently call up here, and this is in the days before cell phones. I would speak to Carolyn, sometimes for extended periods, as Hugh did whatever he was doing before he came to the phone. And so I knew her. She called me the other day, said, I need a title, I need a text for the sermon. And quickly I spit this back to her, and I'd never thought about the way that it would appear. So I apologize for the way it appears. It completely is the opposite of what I would like to communicate. General Douglas MacArthur was famous for telling the people of the Philippines that I will return. Julius Caesar said, Vini, Vidi, Vici, after he was victorious over Germanic tribes. At times we want to take control of our lives. We want to tell people who we are and what we do and what we intend to do. Jesus did the same thing, but with much different attitude than was displayed in the bulletin or from Julius or from MacArthur. Jesus consistently leaves hints. Again, I admit that sometimes in my ignorance, I don't always pay attention to those hints. Sometimes I miss what is just blatantly in front of me and to my loss. Jesus says things like, I have come. This is from the Sermon on the Mount. I have come not to abolish the law, but to fulfill it. I have come not to call righteous, but sinners. I have come to bring a sword. I have come to turn one against another. I have come to bring fire upon the earth and division. I have come to judge the world. I have come from God. I have come to do the will of the one who sent me. I have come as a light so that no one who believes in me should stay in darkness. I have come that they may have life and have it abundantly. This is just a smattering of the instances from Jesus' life in which he declares to his hearers why he's here. I have come for this purpose. It's important that we hear that. It's important that we catch the purpose. Actually, it's important also that his original hearers would have understood this. All of a sudden, here comes this man, and he's not been educated in the right ways. He's not been produced in the typical fashion of a Jewish scholar. He is a blue-collar guy from a no-account town who appears on the scene and has some important and difficult things to say. Some people are stunned. Some people are horrified. Some people are enamored. And so I think that's why consistently Christ has to tell why he's come. I have come to do these things. I have come to initiate this. Don't think that I've come to bring peace. It's a sword. These may be difficult things for us, but we need to take them, and we need to take them in context. The story for today, of course, again, is from Luke chapter 19. And before we read it, I would like to set the background for it. When we read the Gospels, when I read the Gospels, typically what I'll do is start with chapter 1, and then I'll move to chapter 2, and onward. At times, what happens with that is that I miss chronology. Chronology is a big deal for me. When I'm reading a story, I want to know how things occur. I want to know the timeliness of those things. And events in order are important, right? Sometimes we miss some of the stories. Luke tells a certain amount of stories that Matthew and Mark and John exempt. John tells a lot of stories that these other three guys don't record. Sometimes we miss the harmony of those. And we miss then the bigger picture. It's likely, and I wasn't aware of this until a while back, but it's likely that we've missed the entire background of the story of Zacchaeus, not seeing the big picture of all. And here it is. For a while, Jesus preached and taught and did miracles and proved his identity to the people up north, up in the rural lands, those people he knew. On occasion, usually on the holidays, he would make that pilgrimage southward to Jerusalem, and there he would interact. And a lot of the stories that we have come when Jesus visits Jerusalem. Jesus doesn't live there, he visits there. And frequently he does a big thing. On one occasion, John records, at the time of the ceremony of the Feast of Tabernacles, I believe, in John 7 or 8, sorry, while the bowl of water is being poured out to demonstrate God's bounty for the people as they came out of Egypt and were in the wilderness before the promised land, at that moment, Jesus shouts, "Anyone who's thirsty, come to me and I'll give you something to drink." Jesus has a sense of disrupting the sensibilities of your typical Jewish person who's observing things. He strides into town or rides on a donkey perhaps, and suddenly things are disrupted. Previous to Zacchaeus, when Jesus was in Jerusalem, he had created a stir. We find this in John chapter 9. A man had been born blind. Jesus took this man who had been born blind, and he healed him. And this was a big deal. People who had not been able to see had been able to see again, but nobody who had ever been born blind had been able to see for the first time. And so Jesus takes this man born blind and allows him to see. All kinds of chaos is created. John devotes an entire chapter to this. It's 40 or 50 verses, John chapter 9. It's about one incident. And they bring this guy before the magistrates. They bring his parents before the magistrates. "Is this your son? Tell us what happened." "I don't know. He's our son, but you ask him. He's of age." You remember that line? This is the man born blind. Jesus leaves Jerusalem after that holiday, and people are upset. Some people are excited. Some people are astonished. And perhaps they think that maybe the Savior has come. Maybe this long-expected Messiah, maybe he really is all the way. Jesus leaves Jerusalem. And instead of returning north home, he crosses, for you it's this way, he crosses eastward across the Jordan River and stays in sort of a desert no man's land for a while. While he's there, he gets word that his friend has died, his friend Lazarus. Lazarus, oddly, has not been introduced to us very often before this death of his in chapter 11 of John. But apparently, he and Jesus were tight buddies. That's what John tells us. He gets word that John is sick. Jesus tarries a little bit, and then he returns, he crosses, see, how's this go for you, he goes back westwardly, back to Jerusalem, to the town of Bethany, which is on the map about that far from Jerusalem, 2 miles or less. He sort of walks back into the trap, again, the hive is stirring in Jerusalem. Jesus returns here for the sickness and the death, eventually, of Lazarus. There, Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead, which is a big deal because this happens just days before his own crucifixion and his own eventual resurrection. After Jesus raises Lazarus, he slides back eastward again and crosses the Jordan temporarily. And he's there until the next holiday, which is the Passover. That certain Passover that includes the donkey riding in, that one. While he's waiting there, as he begins to leave there and return to Jerusalem, he crosses the Jordan River again, but this time comes into the city of Jericho. Jericho is an important city. You remember from the time of Joshua, right? Joshua fought the battle of Jericho, walls, walking around, no more walls, that kind of thing. Jericho set in an important strategic place. It was a place where the river could be easily forded, although in Joshua's time, the river was stood still, and the people crossed on dry land. Here, the people could just cross the water. Get to Jericho, it was a city of palms. They cut the palm branches. These were the same palm branches used to hosanna Jesus couple days later as he came in. As he comes into the city of Jericho, there are two incidents that are recorded for us. The first one is he runs into a blind guy. Actually, I'm not sure the chronology of these. It could be that one story precedes the other, but for the sake of what I have to say today, two incidents occur, one of which is a blind man named Bartimaeus. Bartimaeus calls, "Let me have my sight. Son of David," he says, which is an important identifier. He recognizes this person as the Son of David. This is an unmistakable messianic context. You don't just call anybody Son of David. "Son of David, have mercy on me. What do you want?" "I want to see." "You have your sight." Also, as he's walking, he sees not a poor blind man, but he sees a rich short man, and he's up there. And he passes that way, and he looks up in that tree, and he says, that was pretty lame. He says, "Zacchaeus, you come down."
No.
Okay, probably not like that. I've done a horrible disservice to myself in the past about remembering the ways that other people have told stories. That's not quite cool. I really doubt that Jesus is wagging his finger. But every time I ever sung the song, we wagged our fingers at Zacchaeus. Which I think is not the way that Jesus speaks. It's not the way that he speaks according to this text. There's a certain gentleness here that we don't get. So, here's the text from Luke chapter 19, the first 10 verses. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. We've already established that. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He, Zacchaeus, wanted to see who Jesus was, but being a short man, he could not because of the crowd. So, he wasn't stupid, which is not our text, but he wasn't stupid. So he ran ahead, he climbed the sycamore fig tree in order to see Jesus, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house tonight." So he, Zacchaeus, came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter. It's funny when people mutter, isn't it? There should be some kind of certain scientific study. We'll come back to text in a second. There should be some certain scientific study done when people mutter. My son mutters. My son's 13 right now. He mutters at me a lot. I'll say something to him about his room or about his job or something else. What'd you say? I have to attest that at times I mutter. When my wife's doing something, wagging her finger, I'm probably muttering audibly, because I want to be heard. I don't want her to hear what I'm saying, but I want her to hear that I'm disgruntled about things. So people are muttering. Again, I would love for someone to show me a scientific study about mutter. What a great word. All the people saw this and began to mutter, "He has gone to be the guest of a sinner." Interesting that they exempt themselves from that. But Zacchaeus stood up and he said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I've cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." Zacchaeus is not very good at math. Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham." Not son of David here, son of Abraham. "For the Son of Man came to seek and save what was lost." Jesus again proclaims why he has come. Here he doesn't use that first person pronoun "I." He uses that other thing, the Son of Man phrase, that we Christians ought to be familiar with. Again, I think this is a deficit. I get to preach to students a lot. 18 to 22-year-olds is sort of where I am. I usually am preaching in shorts and a t-shirt, and I don't want to take anything for granted with them. A lot of times they have these bad images, like Jesus fighting his finger at Zacchaeus. They have these bad images ingrained in their heads, and I'm trying to help clear that up. Not that it's your fault or the church's fault, but sometimes we just have baggage left over that's not true. Son of Man is an important thing, and let's not quickly go past it. To misunderstand or fail to get the importance of this phrase is, I think, difficult, is, I think, tragic for us as Christians. Son of Man was an Old Testament phrase used in Ezekiel a lot, and in Daniel specifically, about a special figure, the special one. It's identifiable with the Messiah, although there's not an equal sign that exists in the Old Testament form. It's just that there are these figures, Messianic and Son of Man. It incidentally, and we won't spend a lot of time here, if you go back to John chapter 1, the Jewish leaders come out to John the Baptist as he's preaching by the river that day, and they ask him some questions. Are you Elijah? Are you the Christ? I can't remember the third one now. But they ask him three questions about his identity. John the Baptist says no to each of those. So there's an expectation that the Jewish people are looking for somebody, or maybe three somebodies, or maybe even more than that. They're looking for somebody to come. Son of Man is just that phrase. Jesus uses it of himself because he can't get in trouble for saying it. But it also gives this hint of messianic stuff to the Jewish people. The Son of Man has come to seek and save that which is lost. And that is where I want to go today.